whom are you outsourcing, and if you are outsourcing, who retains the ownership? We have had cases, I'm just taking the examples, UPSEB outsources the entire billing process to some computer company. Now, as an auditor, the CAG's auditor go to UPSEB, they say, look, we have nothing, we have outsourced our, you know, entire functions to the company. Now, they go to the company, the company says, look, we are a private company, you are a government auditor, you've got nothing to do with us. So, you know, by outsourcing, are you also outsourcing the ownership? And in many cases it is happening that you have kind of outsourced the ownership also, and then, so what happened then, you know, like when we were developing our audit manuals, you know, so then we wrote there, we said that if a government department is outsourcing any of its functions, then they must put through a condition there to the outsourced company that whenever an auditor comes from the CNAG, they must show, they must give the entire data to the CAG. We had to put that kind of a clause, yet it is not being implemented by many of the departments, and this problem of outsourcing, and as a result, the ownership getting diffused remains. Who is the owner of the data? Who is the owner of the system? Is a very important thing. Now, if you are the owner of the data, you will make sure that you retain the data in an absolutely correct and complete form. It does not happen, unfortunately, and that's where the next challenge comes, that the data which you are picking, how are you going to ensure that the data is complete, the data is accurate, the data is safe, and data is secure? And the issue of control comes in there. Avinash made a point, how much controls are good? Control costs money. So you cannot really go without a control. He put through that slide, you know, that you only realize the value of a control when you don't put it. So you put the control, you need to put the control, but then how many controls do you put? I mean, are you really willing to invest that much in putting so many controls which ensure everything to you, but then you find that, you know, value for money is not being achieved? A difficult decision. If you know that Sarbanes-Oxley, you know, when it was implemented in America, and after that whatever studies have been done, they find that the cost of maintaining the systems and the cost of auditing the systems have gone up more than 2 times. Now, I don't know, as a country, can India afford that the cost of developing systems or the cost of monitoring systems, the cost of auditing the systems really go up? We probably cannot afford, you know, this kind of a thing where the cost of implementation of system go up. Big issue, simple issues, you know, that where do you put controls within the system, do you put controls outside the system, what do you do, what is the data collection method? You know, you collected, you know, we have this, World Bank gave some program, some assistance to Tamil Nadu for developing their irrigation potential, and one of the conditions was that within about 4 months' time, they will create a good database of whatever irrigation potential was available in Tamil Nadu. So what they did, they picked up, you know, I mean, teachers in India are the most dispensable lot, so they picked up some teachers, they said, okay, you go and pick up the data from wherever, they gave them a format. Now, the teachers went, you know, without really putting their heart into the job, they picked up some data, and when the data was collated and when we audited this, it's there on our website, you can look into. All our audit reports of the CAG are on our website, which is IT audit reports are on the ICISA, which is ICISA, icisa.cag.gov.in. You go there, all our reports are there, including this one. So when, you know, we looked into the data, we found that there were wells who had diameter of more than a kilometer. And there were wells, you know, which had a depth only of, you know, 1 meter, things like that. Because all the data had really been, it. Now, after that, you know, when we were auditing, we were not very sure that where did the mistake occur. Did the mistake occur when they were collecting the data? Or did the mistake occur when they were transferring the data from a paper to the computer? Or did the mistake occur, you know, when we were processing the data? Now, that required, you know, going through the entire process would have taken much more time. So the point is, you are collecting data, and this again the point made by, you know, one of the speakers, that you are collecting data, is so much of data, are you going to make good use of the data? And if you are not going to make good use of the data, why are we collecting so much of data? Quite a few of our audit reports, I remember we started by saying that the project ab initio was ill-conceived, and then we went on to explain that the information what they wanted to get, the required data was not available. Either it was not available or it was not possible for them to collect that data. So if you're not having the required data, how can you really get the information what you want? So the point is, somewhere there has to be a perfect match between what is your information requirement to what is the data available to where is the data available, and are you really trying to capture the data at the first source, or are you trying to get the data converted into something else and then, you know, picking up there? And what is the cost of data collection? Again, the cost becomes very important. If the cost of data collection is very high, and if it is not really going to add that much value to your decision making, you've got to decide that should you go for this or not. I recall another example, and I worked in Botswana for some time. And you know, Botswana is a semi-arid country, you know, lots of desert and all that. And distance between two villages would turn out to be maybe 50 kilometers or 100 kilometers, something like that. So they wanted to develop a system for monitoring the receipts for water supply. And the receipt would be some 20 pula, 30 pula. Pula is the currency of Botswana. So they worked out a lovely system, took help from some IT firm. And then they sent out their data entry operators with the handheld meters. So with the handheld meters, you know, they traveled to all these villages, they picked up the data, 20 pula, 25 pula, 30 pula, something like that. And the villagers said, look, we don't have any money, we are not going to pay it. So they never paid. So they had a wonderful system, you know, which cost them millions of dollars. But then they really could not get anything out of the system. So how costly is going to be your data collection? You know, again, that issue comes up. And finally, the last point and the very important point, the challenge is about the re-engineering. You go for computerization, you computerize, you know, a particular process. Have you really re-engineered it? Have you really thought that the existing process, the mistakes or the, you know, the shortcomings of the existing process must be removed before you go on to that? Now, in most cases, I find that the systems as they exist gets translated into a computerized system and they do not serve any purpose. I can give a very wonderful example when we come to computerizing the accounts. In the good old days when accounts were manual, you know, you will have millions of vouchers coming to you, and the vouchers will have to be segregated in various heads of accounts. So then they will segregate the vouchers in various heads of accounts, and then for each head of account they will prepare a compilation sheet. From the compilation sheet, that's the first step. Then they'll go to a classified abstract, then they will go to a consolidated abstract, then they prepare the monthly account. When they went for computerization, they followed the entire process like this. First preparing the classified abstract, they could have just, you know, picked up the data and classified it to wherever they were. But then they went into all these things, and the system certainly is not as functional as it should have been. So I think re-engineering is one of the most important aspects. And remember, you know, Mr. Sam Pitroda, when he was in the Knowledge Center, he wrote a letter to the, you know, Dr. Manmohan Singh at that point of time, giving some 16 or 17 reasons as to why computerization in government fails. And the point that, you know, re-engineering is not being resorted to was the first and the most important point. Well, friends, this is what I just thought I'll share with you a little bit. You can, as I say, you can go through on our IT audits and you will find that many such problems have been highlighted in most of our reports. Thank you.
Are there any questions from the audience? I'm sure there are many. So who would like to be the first baller? Please.
Hi, my name is Sanjeev Tripathi. I am from RBS in Gurgaon. Referring to what Mr. Srinath said, I'm just wondering, after all the speakers have spoken, where is the action? We got a lot of information. So frankly speaking, you know, one of the things that I kind of picked up, which is quite common in the corporate world in terms of data storage, a very common problem is a lot of us, you know, use our PSTs where data gets stored. And if you look at a high size email which gets stored by 20 different people and that get ultimately stored, you know, actually multiplying the data storage. You know, so one of the things I would like to, you know, see over the next 2 days is when we talk about problems, can we also share some of the innovative ways which other companies have done it so that we learn from it?
Yeah, thank you so much. I think that is the intention of today's panel discussion. Raise a lot of topics, raise a lot of issues, and hopefully in the next 2 days, various speakers are going to give you answers to these anxieties that we have got. Right? So, any other question? Yeah, I can add a little to that. So the data storage, I mean, that's obviously, I very briefly talked about, you know, the problem with too much data, right? But the point that you made is a very good one, which is that data is not only growing, but it's not exist. It no longer exists primarily in its traditional form. Traditional form, it was all in databases, right? Anything that mattered. But there is increasingly more amount of sensitive and critical information in unstructured data, which means they are in spreadsheets. They are, you know, they are even in your chats. If you are using chats within your organization, they are in all kinds of places. They are spread over, you know, devices, servers, all over the place. So the big ways in which people are trying to address it is that the data, you know, information management systems themselves have gotten better with storing and managing unstructured data. So when I talked about for example, data classification, because now there's so much of data lying in so many places, you need to have you know, technology and systems that can help you classify, help you figure out, no matter what form that data exists in. So there's more investment into those technologies to do it.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Sandeep Godbole. I just want to touch upon what Avinash referred to. I hope I'm not attributing this to some other speaker. The cooperation of things, which is what a lot of people are talking about. They may give different nomenclatures. People talk about it in terms of the Internet of Things and all these areas. So. At a very macro level, I'm not talking about controls and I'm talking at the framework level. So in terms of that, do you see any high level family of risks emerging from this trend?
So Internet of Things, I mean you hear a lot of about it, and we don't realize that, you know, when we think about computers, we pretty much tend to still think of them in the forms that we were more familiar with, which is your desktop, laptop computers, you know, the smartphone that you hold. Many people won't refer to them as computing devices, but actually they are much more powerful computing devices today than before. But the important thing to know when we talk about things talking to each other are things like, for example, your printer. I mean, there was recently a malware attack which specifically exploited printers, because there are a lot of printers that today are connected to the internet, and most people don't realize it. And they're connected to the internet because the vendor can do diagnostics or do proactive management of those. The downside of those technologies, obviously, as you can imagine, I mean, that helps in a significant way. Because now you know, the vendor can know that there is a problem. It's sort of like Boeing handles their jet engines, right, or Rolls-Royce, I mean, the aircraft engines. Many a times, even before the airline knows that there is a problem or potential problem, they know it because the engines are directly talking back to their, you know, their manufacturers. And similarly, there are printers have begun to do that, and other things have begun to do that. But when sophistication increases in one level, there are risks that start appearing in other levels. So this new malware that I was talking about specifically targeted that channel, and they were trying to spread through that. It so happened that the writer of that malware created a bug which led to a lot of empty pages being printed out, and that's the reason it got detected, actually. Incidentally, that malware was widely spread in India as well.
Just to add, I gave an example about smart cars having a lot of embedded systems. And one of the things that I talked about is that, with the smart cars, you can remotely start the car, remotely stop the car, remotely block the car. If all of these things you can do, can a hacker take over that function and do the same thing to your car? So this Internet of Things or connectivity of things or cooperation of things, or the other example about doctor using iPad to control the drug to administer to you through your pacemaker or through your embedded device. Now, could there be something which can go wrong, and that could be a life-threatening sort of issue? So we yet do not know the dimension of these things. And as always, the functionality is more important for us rather than the security, because security would be investment. And do we really want to have investment, or do we not have a jazzy functionality, jazzy app, start using it? If something happens, we worry about it later. Any other question? Yeah. Yeah, two questions.
Sir, I am Vikas from Karur Vysya Bank. My question to will be regarding re-engineering. Re-engineering, whenever we are talking about, we are most of the time talking about the changing operational activity in and around the organization, or sometimes what happens, like suppose one organization exists from past. So there are lot many employees in the organization who have given the best to their for the company to grow, or they may be proud to just give the best to their company. But when we are talking about re-engineering, sometimes like we are about to implement something that person may not be known or unknown, or sometimes like board senior level executives, they may be voluntarily welcoming that sort of a change. But bringing that change in a specified period of time, keeping our organization's existing culture into view, it seems quite difficult. So your comment on that, sir, would like.
Well, I think a good manager is one who makes difficult things look easy. So somewhere, if these things do look difficult, that you are having an existing process, you're converting the process into an IT-based process. But then you've got to look into your process, whether your process is efficient or does it require a different kind of makeover, you know, when you are converting into the IT. And then in this entire, development of an IT system, how are you going to manage the change period? Now that's something which has to be looked into. It could be that you develop a system and continue on the manual system, come and have a cutoff date and start off, or you run a parallel this thing. Plenty of ways in doing it. But then it depends on the organization, it depends on how much you are computerizing, what extent you are putting. I think it all will depend. But then re-engineering is a must. You don't go, maybe by re-engineering you don't change any process, maybe your process is good enough. But you have to have a look at whether it is worth going into the same process, or you would like to introduce certain changes or remove certain steps, or add certain steps, whatever. I gave you the example, there's no need to go step by step. When you go for accounts computerization, you can straightway pick up the data and then go into whatever kind of reports you want. Much simpler.
I'll just add one example here. Anybody remembers, I'm just looking at some white hair, the banking, when computerization was introduced, there was a system called ALPM, Automated Ledger Processing Machine. And that machine was a PC, and 1,000 accounts were given to one machine. So like a bank, manual bank, there will be multiple windows behind which one person with a computer, and it will handle only those 1,000.
Only those 1,000. So that is it. Yeah.
So don't you think that re-engineering is absolutely a must? Yeah, we have to be least disruptive, but there is no option. We cannot take a manual process and just copy that manual process into an automated process. Yeah.
Hi, my name is Partha Sarathi. I'm from First Gulf Bank. This is a specific question to Mr. Ghosh. Mr. Ghosh was speaking about multiple security devices creating a large amount of data, and all this data lying in silos in the monitoring system, and you depend upon human being to correlate it when you have diverse systems. So is there any trend of creating system which can consolidate all these things to give a from a data to an MIS for the security officer?
Yeah, so yes, I mean, obviously when I was, my own experience is mostly focused around security, but what happens, I mean, if you look at how the world of security still operates, unfortunately, is that, the people dealing with security sort of trying to approach the problem like that in a leaky boat, where a new leak is uncovered and you plug it. So the moment WikiLeaks happened and there was a lot of talk around sensitive information leaking out, suddenly there was a whole bunch of data loss prevention products that got deployed right in the companies. So in the world of security, you'll notice that with any new attack vector that gets discovered, there is a new product that just gets put in. The problem is, and like I told you, I mean, many companies obviously start off trying to meet their regulatory compliance requirements. So now they have all these products, they are doing their audits. But when they start trying to figure out, is this really helping me as a company? I mean, how does this directly correlate? I'm taking care of external stakeholders, checking all those boxes, but how does this correlate? At that point, they realize that they have all these information that doesn't seem to be very actionable, because you have all these security products which are spewing out a lot of data, right? I mean, there are a lot of incidents happening. There's a lot of, I mean, for example, companies who get really good at doing assessments automatically, I mean, their problem actually changes a little. So earlier, in the initial stages, they assess themselves by how frequently can they do those technical assessments, right? So normally, I mean, in our case, we notice that people in a large company, I mean, I'm talking about companies that have 100,000 servers. So global bank as an example, you know, they were doing assessments once a year. So they came down all the way through automation to about once in 2 weeks. So at one level, the CISO was feeling very good and patting himself on the back that, hey, look how fast I can do my assessments. But the problem had just shifted because now there was too much data with him. He is not able to process data. And one of the big problems that security organizations in general have in companies is that they cannot connect very well with the businesses. Meaning, so it's sometimes a very adversarial role because you are seen as a, you know, a person who's not an enabler, right, for business. So you're always getting in the way. So now you tell them that, hey, you have got to do these things, or this server needs, something needs to happen, and they can't really understand what this guy is talking about and why it's really important for me. So they want to make sense out of it and convert it into business terms. So the correlation work specifically that I've seen a lot of people interested in my area of expertise is how do you take all that data that you're anyway collecting for compliance, for other kinds of security monitoring and things, and put a business lens around it, collect all that data together, mash it up, and be able to make it actionable, one, which means correlate data in a way which makes sense, which can allow you to take some specific actions. But the second thing also, which I probably didn't mention, is how do you translate it into business terms that a person will understand? Because remember that while you can point out the risks, the person or persons who's responsible for doing something about it probably is outside of your jurisdiction. They are part of the BUs and the other units. So instead of saying that, look, if you can correlate it and say that the most important thing for me to do is fix something in that server, you need to be able to say that, look, this actually relates to a very high degree of risk in your trading systems, if you are a bank, for example. You know, and so you need to be able to make that correlation. And right now, we have actually a lot of innovation happening in that direction, specifically, which can do that.
Yeah, I'm Sandeep Singh from Indian Oil. That's a question to Santanu. We have seen the grand old days of actually controlling laptops entering into systems, putting a lot of controls like antiviruses and anti-malware devices. But it's not actually, frankly speaking, happening in case of BIOD devices, mostly are Android-based. So I feel it's going to be really difficult to putting all those controls, because in case of desktops and laptops, you can have NAC and all these things put up by companies like Symantec and McAfee's. But it's not actually coming in the ways of mobile devices. And you are actually forced to get it into your corporates, these devices. You cannot help it, as you said, bring from the top, getting it from the top. So how actually are you thinking of putting it? Because it's going to be there in your systems. And the controls will not be as strong as you can put in a laptop. So it's actually open to all the, I'd say,
all right,
government and everybody.
Yeah. This is, I mean, one way in which I talk about it sometimes is calling that, the world that we were in, security 1.0, where the approach was that it's a yes-no kind of a thing, where the security person will tell you can't do that, so you have to have these 5 controls in place, otherwise that's it, you can't use it. So it was more like the model was where you basically, it was very black and white, you can't do it, and it was more security was operated in a way which was like that. Now, what I call security 2.0, which is the direction that not only we are headed, obviously we have been in that for a while, but a lot of companies are headed, is what we call the security 2.0, or the new generation of security, where security is more an enabling technology rather than something that gets in your way. Especially in the case of BYOD, actually BYOD is I didn't cover it in too much detail, but the way you have to look at it is in multiple ways, right? Because when you talk about BYOD, essentially you have information that you as a company cares about, and you want to safeguard, protect, and make sure that you have an ability to back it up, etc. But on the other hand, there is also personal data there. And so, especially with privacy laws and all these getting stronger even in countries here, one of the things you'll notice that, you just can't go and take back that entire laptop up because you don't want to be, taking something that is of, you know, not really, doesn't belong to the company. Similarly, on mobile devices, for example, one of the most common security requirements is doing mobile wipes if you lose those devices, right? Whether it's an Android or an iPhone device. I mean, one of the basic things people want to do is if you lose a device, the moment you declare it, you need to have remote wiping capability so you can destroy the data there. Now, even when you do that, there are policy related things, etc., that have to be put into place, because if you destroy a personal data of somebody, I mean, what are the implications? All these have to be worked out well. I mean, you either need to have a policy that the employees have signed up for when they use BYOD. There are important things like that.